الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. One of the greatest ni'mas that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us rules, regulations, laws for us to live our lives by. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created humans, when He created me and you, He placed inside of us two abilities. One ability is the ability to listen and to obey. And the other ability is the ability to be able to do whatever we want. And this is why we see from the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, He gave him something that me and you call free will. Free will means that we can use our tongues the way we want to use them. We can say whatever we want. We can use our eyes the way we want to use them. We can look at whatever we want. We can use our hands in whichever way we want to use them. We can touch whatever we want. We can go wherever we want. We can meet with whoever we want. We can eat whatever we want. This is the choices that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me and you in this dunya. Each and every single one of us, since the time we are born until we die, each and every single one of us can live the life as we like. However, if a person lives their life in whichever way he wants, there will always be consequences. If you eat whatever you want, your body will suffer the consequences of that food. If you touch and take whatever you want, you will be responsible for what you touch and you take. If you talk about whatever you want, you will have to face the consequences of your words. We see this on a daily basis. Some people, they talk to their friends, and one word slips from their mouth, and that friendship is over. Sometimes at home we are with our relatives, and at the spur of anger, we say something to our parents, we say something to our uncles and aunties, we say something about our cousins, our nephews, brothers and sisters, and what happens? For years, we don't speak to each other ever again. Sometimes we go to certain places, we have this reputation, and now we're starting going to these places and meeting with these certain types of people. What happens is now people have lost our respect. We have dropped in the eyes of people because we start going to these certain places. This is the consequences of our actions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has clearly said that إِنَّ السَّمْعَ the hearing وَالْبَصَرَ your seeing, والفؤاد, the way you think, every single thing will be taken account. Every single thing will be held responsible on the day of judgment. Now let me give you an example. In your society, there is a man, and this man, he earns his living by going work every morning, and every evening he comes back, and then he collects that money, and then he takes this money, and he builds an orphanage. Or he helps an orphanage. And those people who come to that orphanage, those little children whose parents have passed away or have been left there, they are being brought up, taken care of, food is being provided for them. This man, through his own will and through his own actions, he has done something, and now the benefits of that he will reap. In this dunya, people will have respect and high honor for him. And in the hereafter, when he comes in front of Almighty Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever takes care of an orphan in this dunya, me and him will be like this on the day of judgment. And he raised his two fingers and he said, we will be like this. And this is the reward, my brothers, of a person through his own free will who does a good action in society. And then on the opposite, you can have the other type of person. A person who lives his life, who goes, gets up in the morning, who earns his living however he wants to earn, whether it's a legal way, whether it's illegal, he gets that money, and then he goes and then he buys for himself something which he wants to fulfill his own desires. He may buy some food which he's not supposed to eat. He may buy some drink which he's not supposed to drink. He may go and use it on certain people that he's not supposed to go and use it on. And then what happens is that the consequences of that is that his society will look down upon him. His own brothers and sisters and mother and father will look down upon what he's doing in society. And then when he goes back to Almighty Allah on the Day of Judgment, when he has to stand in front of his Creator, Allah is going to question him about where he got that money from and how he spent it. So our religion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, my brothers, is a religion of discipline. A religion of a person who controls and suppresses his own desires and needs for what Allah azza wa jal wants. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent Adam alayhi salam to this dunya, he said, إِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُم مِّنِّي هُدَى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَا فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. O Adam, guidance will come to you from me. And whoever follows this guidance that comes from me, اتَّبَعَ هُدَايَا. The word Allah uses, اتَّبَعَ. اتَّبَعَ means a person who follows something to the minute detail. تَبِعَ, it means to follow. مَنْ اتَّبَعَ, it means to follow something to the minute detail. Whoever follows my laws, my guidance, to the minute detail. Whoever follows the things that I tell them to speak. Whoever follows the things I tell them not to say. Whoever follows the things I tell them to look at. Whoever follows the things that I tell them not to look at. All of these things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us in our religion, these are all guidance from Allah. Whoever follows this, Allah says two things he will get. La khawfun alayhim. He will not have any fear upon him. What does it mean not to have fear upon a person? In the Arabic language, khawf, it means to fear something that is going to happen. It hasn't happened yet. For example, it's a dark street. You're walking down the road. Nothing is there, but you fear, what if someone robs me? This is called khawf. Or for example, you're driving down the road and you see kids playing football on the street and you're scared, you have the fear that what if I drive my car and all of a sudden a child runs out to get the football and I hit him. So you have this fear. So here the Arab, in the Arabic language, لا خوف عليهم. عليهم means that there will be no fear upon them. Just like the little child. You're driving your car, the child is not scared of the car. He runs straight into the road, picks up the ball, looks at the car, smiles and runs away. He has no fear. Who has the fear? The driver has the fear. So Allah says that لا خوف عليهم means here is that a human, he will not fear himself. Nor will other people fear for what is going to happen to him. There'll be no fear, just like this child. That there will be no fear for what will happen to this child. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect us from the difficulties of this dunya. And on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect us from the great azab of the Day of Judgment. This is the promise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes for who, my brothers? Who is this promise for? Is this promise for that person who misses their five times salah? Is this promise for that person who doesn't get up for the Fajr salah in the morning? Is this for that person who does not respect their parents, who doesn't honor their relatives, and doesn't show kindness to their youngsters and to their neighbors? No, my brothers, this is for that person who follows the guidance of Allah. لا خوف عليهم, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. ولا هم يحزنون, Allah says. And they will not have any grief. Now listen to this very carefully. This is a very interesting point. In our society that we're living in today, one of the biggest social illnesses that we have today is the illness, or medical illnesses that we have today, is the illness of people going into depression. How many of us know people in our family who are in depression? And how many of us have been in depression ourselves? This is a common thing that is happening nowadays. You don't hear about it in the past too much. But nowadays it's becoming more. People are buying more tablets to put themselves to sleep. People are going to the chemist, they're going to the doctors. I can't go to sleep at night. I've got problems at home. I feel suicidal. These are the kind of problems that people, you know, mention nowadays. Why is this, my brothers? There must be a reason. Allah doesn't put us in this dunya and then we suffer the consequences of living in this dunya. There's always a reason behind every single problem in our society. And the problems can be solved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ دَاءً إِلَّا أَنزَلَ لَهُ شِفَاءً. Allah has not revealed an illness in the world except He has placed for it a solution. There is a solution for every single problem we have in this dunya, whether it's an illness of the body or whether it's an illness of our soul. The illnesses have their cures, my brothers. This is something that me and you need to understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Because when a person, he practices his religion, when a person obeys Almighty Allah, when a person, he holds fast to the teachings of what Allah says, he has a choice in life. He has money, he can buy with this money alcohol, he can buy with this money some sort of a drink which is permissible. And he has a choice here. He can go and use this money to buy himself marijuana, weed, drugs, or he can go and use this money to buy food for his friends and family. He has a choice. He can use this money to use it in a place that he's not supposed to go, or he can use it in a place where he is supposed to go. This is a choice Allah has given every human. Allah is not going to question you in this dunya. Remember this, my brothers. When we spend that money in the right place, or we spend that money in the wrong place, you're not going to wake up tomorrow morning and Allah will have a big list of questions for you. No, my brothers, this is not how the dunya works. Allah sent us to this dunya, لِنَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah says, we send you to this dunya to check which one of you does the best deeds, أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, the best actions. And so this dunya is a test for us. It's an exam for us. There's no pens in this exam. There's no papers in this exam. There's no cheating in this exam. Allah has given us all of the answers for this exam. It's just about me and you applying it. So my brothers, what happens? When we spend this money, when we spend our time, when we spend our energy in obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then we think to ourselves, have I lost anything? The money I spent on my parents, have I lost it? The money I spent on the orphans in Syria, have I lost it? The money I spent in building a masjid, have I lost it? No, my brothers, we haven't lost anything. Why? Because you only think that you lost something when you've used it in the wrong place. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say? He said, I swear by Allah, a person will never diminish in his wealth if he spends in charity. A person will never diminish in his wealth if he spends in charity. Why? Because when you're taking money out of one pocket and you're putting it into the other pocket, are you losing money? You're not losing money. When you take money out of your pocket and you give it to the poor, it's like you're saving for yourself in the hereafter a big bank account. And so when you come to Almighty Allah, you'll have this big reserve of money, of hereafter currency, that will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will enter you into Jannah. This is why لَا يَحْزَنُونَ, Allah says, لَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. The Muslim in his life should never ever be sad. If a Muslim loses a person in his family, a Muslim, what do we always say? إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Just recently we heard, you know, Dr. Naseem from Central Mosque, and he was a local GP is down the road. And he was a person, 40 years, subhanAllah, he was serving the masjid, 40 years. You know, I'm not even 40 years old. He was serving the masjid before I was born. You know, this shows the kind of commitment that he gave. Allah only knows the reward that He's going to give him. May Allah forgive his sins. Every human makes mistakes, my brothers. But look at the effort that he made in this dunya. Now, is he going to be grieving about spending 40 years serving a masjid? Do you think he's going to be sad? When he's in his grave, do you think he's going to be upset that 40 years of his life, let's say he was 90 years old, 40 years of his life, which is almost about 50% of his life, he spent in serving a masjid of Allah. SubhanAllah, my brothers. Think about that. Just think, how much time do we give to our own masjid? La hum yahzanun, my brothers. Why? Because when you discipline yourself with the laws of Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will naturally give inside of your body contentment. You'll feel contentment. When someone passes away, we say Inna Lillahi wa Inna Ilayhi Raji'un. Why do we say Inna Lillahi wa Inna Ilayhi Raji'un? We say this because we know, me and you know, that we are going to go back to Allah. Inna Lillah, we are for Allah, and to Allah we are going to return. This is what it means. My hat will return to Allah. My body will return to Allah. My clothes will return to Allah. What does this mean? It means everything, all our bodies may die in this dunya, but everything is going to be owned by Allah once again. He will take everything back. Inna nahnu narithu al-ardha wa man 'alayha, Allah says, we will take back everything that we own. A day will come, we will take back the sun. Allah will take back the earth. Allah will take back the mountains. Even this masjid will be taken back by Allah. A day will come like this, my brothers. This is the promise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes. But remember, my brothers, if you lived in this dunya with discipline, Allah azza wa jal is going to give you such a reward on the day of judgment. When Allah describes it in the Quran, He says, وَمَن يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger in this dunya, then أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ, those are the people who are successful. Those are the people who are truly successful. Now let's look at me and you in our lives, my brothers. We know that in our lives we have free will. Every morning we get up, every night we go to sleep, every day we eat, every day we drink, every day we speak, every day we go about places, we send text messages, we send emails, we drive. There's so many things that we do in our day, my brothers. But how many of these things are done according to the pleasure of Allah? How many of these things are done that if we were to think to ourselves, would Allah be happy with me the way I woke up in the morning today? Would Allah be happy at the time that I got up? Would Allah be happy with the way, the kind of clothing that I was wearing? Would Allah be happy with me that the food that I was eating? Would Allah be happy with me the way that I was speaking today? These are all things, my brothers, that are part of our religion. Many people, they just have this conception that the dunya that we live in is not our religion. Religion is only in the masjid. Religion is not in the masjid, my brothers. If you look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught the sahaba more things about outside of the masjid than inside of the masjid. He spent more time in explaining to people about the rights of other people. He spent more time in explaining to people of how they should show kindness to not even Muslims, to even non-Muslims. Never mind humans, to even to the animals, my brothers. This is the kind of religion that we have. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He talks about the worst people of the in history, you know how He explains. Allah says that فَخَلَفَ مِن بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ, after the initial Bani Israel, those who came before, after they died, Musa alayhi salam went away, the prophets went, Allah said, خَلَفَ مِن بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ, a wretched group of people were brought up in society. أَضَاءُ الصَّلَاةِ, they messed up their salah. أَضَاءُ الصَّلَاةِ, Allah did not say they left their salah, تَرَكُ الصَّلَاةِ, no. Allah says, أَضَاءُ الصَّلَاةِ, what does that mean? Why does Allah say, أَضَاءَ? أَضَاءَ in the Arabic language, it means, I'm going to finish on this, أَضَاءَ in the Arabic language means to waste something, to not utilize it correctly. If a person has a car, and then this person takes this car and puts this car into his front room and begins to sit inside the car, or begins to lie down on the car and makes it into his bed, has he used the car for its purpose? No, he hasn't. He has adaa sayyara, the Arabs would say. He has wasted the car. So what does this mean? It means when we start practicing our religion, what tends to happen is we waste our salat. We think to ourselves that salat is a burden. Salat is something that only people who have white hair in their beards. Salat is something that only when you reach the age of 40 you start doing. Salat is something that you only do in the masjid, you don't do it at home. No, my brothers. Salat is your way of your life. You should be thinking about your salat from morning to evening. Not just thinking about how to perform salat, my brothers, but the actions inside of salat should project outside of your life as well. The way you control your tongue inside of your salat, the way you control your limbs inside of salat. These are all things that should be done outside of salat. Salat is a manifestation of discipline in our lives. And discipline is something that me and you are missing at various levels in our life. You know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the understanding. But the interesting point I just want to finish upon is when Allah after that says, وَاتَّبَعُوا الشَّهَوَاتِ, Allah says, worse than that, they started to follow, you know, to the minute detail, their own wishes and desires. Now look at the society that we live in today. Never mind the non-Muslims, just look at the Muslims. When we want to park our car on the roads, we don't care about the traffic behind us. We park our car right in the middle. And if they were to shout at us, we'll get out of the car and we show them who's boss. That's how it is, isn't it? When we want to park our car and our neighbors don't have a space, we don't care. We'll park in front of our neighbor's house and block their house. We don't care. It's our car, free country. This is the kind of mentality we have, whereas the Prophet ﷺ was teaching something else. He was teaching the Sahaba how to become good Muslims. You know, so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me and you the understanding. And I just want to finish off on how we can rectify ourselves. Just two things, my brothers, which I think which are beneficial for me and beneficial for you. Number one, my brothers, we need to understand that we make mistakes. Once we understand that we are fallible to mistakes, that we make mistakes in every step of our life, that's the first thing that will help us to make us better people. The second thing we need to understand also is our community has rights over us as well. If we don't help our community in this masjid, if we don't help our community out there, then what will happen is we become very selfish Muslims, self-centered Muslims, egocentric Muslims. And we just care about ourselves, we don't care about any other Muslim down the road. He's from this village, he's from here, we don't care, we're from this place. This is the kind of problems that we have in all of our areas, my brothers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me the ability to be able to practice what I've just said. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow this masjid to prosper. And through your benefit, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow this masjid to become a center of the locality. Wa sallallahu ta'ala ala khayri khalqi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.